north of Ireland, a battlefield where religious and political differences are dealt with by bombs and bullets. The cost of the conflict, in the past 15 years alone, 2,500 killed, 25,000 maimed, an economy destroyed, and an entire generation raised in violence. The border. Here, Northern Ireland meets the Republic. The land looks the same on both sides, but the divisions between the two are deep. The predominantly Catholic South won its fight to be independent from Britain in 1922. The North, where Protestants are the majority, refused to sever the connection with the British Crown and demanded separation from the rest of Ireland. Thus, the Catholics of the North became a minority. 60 years of conflict followed. Will it ever end? There are those in the North who believe that there is hope. They have chosen not to die, but to live for Ireland. My great-grandfather, whose name was also Michael Farrell, came here in the middle 1850s from Ireland, from County Longford, Ireland. With another group of Irish immigrants, he settled in Minnesota and founded a town, which they named after the town of his birth, Rosemount. My father was born in Rosemount, Minnesota. And like him, I share a great sense of joy in the Irish traditions, the Irish heritage. And I think when people think of Ireland, they think of song and love and gaiety and laughter. And the little people, a lot of the happiness. Unfortunately, in the recent past, there's another aspect of Ireland that's permeated our thoughts, and that is the Ireland of violence, particularly the troubles that beset Northern Ireland. The political turmoil there has been a cause of great grief to all of us, Irish and non-Irish. The media tends to focus on the more sensational aspects of the news, and as a result of that, focuses on the most violent groups, the most violent acts, and makes us wonder if there's ever a hope for ending the troubles in Ireland. What we'd like to offer you today is another view of Ireland and the political developments there. In the 1960s, the Catholics of the North united in a civil rights movement dedicated to nonviolent social change. They were determined to end a system where the unionist Protestant majority controlled jobs, housing, and dominated political life. Out of this movement, a group of civil rights leaders formed the Social Democratic and Labor Party, the SDLP, to carry the movement's aims into the political arena. Among them was Seamus Mallon, now deputy leader of the SDLP, here with his daughter in County Armagh.
All of the Catholic people and all of the Protestant people in Northern Ireland are not all going to die on the same morning. They're not all going to slip off the side of Belfast Lough or into Lough Neagh. They're going to be there. They're going to be living in Northern Ireland. Now, they have two choices. Either they can choose to live together in Northern Ireland under a just political settlement where justice is done as seen to be done and every person has his right to his place in the sun, or we can continue with what we're doing, and that is killing people, having total political instability, having gross unemployment, and having a quality of life which is a disgrace in this modern age within the context of a new Europe. That's the choice facing us.
On November 15, 1985, Garrett Fitzgerald, head of the Irish government, and British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher signed an historic agreement which gave Dublin a voice in Northern Ireland. An intergovernmental conference is now in place in which Irish civil servants confer with their British counterparts on all matters relating to the Catholic nationalist minority in Northern Ireland, especially in areas of security and legal affairs. Some of the Protestant leaders fear the agreement because they don't wish any involvement with the Republic. The IRA has denounced the agreement because they see it as an acknowledgement of a separate Northern Ireland. In the United States, in a rare moment of unanimity, President Reagan and House Speaker Tip O'Neill made a joint announcement of support and pledged financial aid for those people, North and South, who have suffered through the long years of violence. This agreement gives great encouragement to those people in the North who are committed to nonviolence and working within the democratic process. They work quietly, with a little attention, and at great personal risk. I've had the opportunity to meet with one of their leaders, who coincidentally was born in a section of Derry called Rosemount. His name is John Hume.
John Hume, leader of the Social Democratic and Labour Party, was elected to the British Parliament in 1983. He's the first Catholic member of Parliament from Derry in 300 years. Hume keeps close to his constituents, traveling from village to village campaigning against those who use violence as a political weapon, whether they be extremists from the Protestant community or members of the Provost, the Provisional Irish Republican Army.
The fundamental difference between the IRA and ourselves is, of course, that we don't believe in the use of violence, because we believe that Ireland is only a piece of earth without its people, that the real wealth of any country is its people. Without its people, it's only a jungle like any other piece of earth. And we believe in preserving our wealth, preserving our people. And we believe that violence only divides them and embitters them. And that would be the most fundamental difference between us. Secondly, of course, we don't believe that you can defend human rights by attacking human rights. We don't believe that you can be a credible defender of the human rights of the people of Ireland by attacking the most fundamental human right of all, the right to life, by taking people's lives for political purposes, by killing people. Because if you're prepared to kill somebody for a political objective, then what value is left? What rights are left? And I think that that's a question that's not often asked of those who portray themselves as patriots with guns in their hands.
Among the more than 40 million Americans proud to claim Irish heritage are some whose romantic notions about the old country make them easy prey for those who equate Irish patriotism with support for violence. So the SDLP sent his representatives John and Bernadette Tierney to bring a different message. 33 years old, Tierney was unemployed when elected Lord Mayor of Derry, an office held exclusively by Protestants for centuries. On his U.S. tour, Mayor Tierney met Mayor Ed Koch of New York.
Now, my people don't give me one of these.
No. All the mayors that I have seen, I've seen the mayor of Los Angeles, the mayor of Portland, and the mayor of Washington, they all say the same.
Right, we're all very envious of...
Well, maybe you could put it on for a photograph.
Oh, I'd like to do that. Yes, yeah. Right, the only time I ever get next to one of these people. Now, I just have... I'm not allowed to wear this into the subway.
Oh, nice.
Too tempting.
Any British government, no matter which party they belong to, any British government, they have to find a solution to the problem.
At a reception given by Commonweal magazine in New York, Tierney told his audience that the Catholics of the North longed for a just solution. Peace through accommodation of differences. That's the SDLP view. Michael Collins of the Irish Consulate welcomed Tierney's message.
Bring forth and bring to attention the elements within Northern Ireland that are perhaps least well understood here. They are the elements essentially that represents peace with fairness, peace with moderation, and peace through nonviolence. And as I say, from our point of view, we welcome John here, and we support what he supports. Thank you.
Yeah.
It's so self-evident that it shouldn't surprise anybody that the vast majority of the Catholic people of the north of Ireland consistently support that view at the ballot box and consistently support my party as the people to speak for them. One would imagine, reading some of the media in this country, that the IRA spoke for the entire Catholic population. They don't. They speak for a minority of it. And they speak for a very tiny minority, indeed, of the people of Ireland as a whole. The city of Derry, where I live myself, is in a way a microcosm of the whole Irish problem, because it's the place where the two traditions in Ireland meet in strength. And they meet in the same sort of proportions as they are in the island as a whole.
In May 1985, Sinn Fein, the political wing of the IRA, ran candidates in local elections as a challenge to the SDLP. The question was, who would speak for the Catholic people of the North?
And the unionist politicians and indeed the media are totally wrong when they say the boycotted Republican stronghold. People may be Republican, but they support nonviolence. And they support the SDLP.
And they support John Tierney.
John Tierney's a very good person. We've lived with them in the high flats. And in fact, we've danced with them, the dances, you know. But I never thought he would go in for politics. Well, in the Bogside, he's very popular, you know.
It was here in the Bogside, heart of the Catholic ghetto in Derry, where 13 nonviolent marchers were shot dead by British paratroopers on the January day in 1972, now known as Bloody Sunday. The anger this generated led some to pledge their lives to an armed struggle. But the SDLP offered another way to serve.
We have had handed down to us a rather romantic notion about Irish patriotism, that it is patriotic to die for your country. And of course that has been translated by our modern day men of violence into that it's also patriotic to kill for your country. And when you're talking about your country in Ireland, you're talking about your own people. You're talking about killing your own people because we are a divided people. My view is that we want to develop a concept of Irish patriotism for our young people, whereby we want our young people to live for Ireland, not to die for it. We want our young people to spill their sweat for Ireland, not their blood.
For John Tierney, this means canvassing for other SDLP candidates for the city council at the same time as he himself runs for re-election. Paul O'Donnell, 21, the youngest candidate, chose to become involved in the political process at a time when some of the young men from his housing project had chosen paramilitary groups like the IRA. The people of his community are proud of Paul's commitment, his mother most of all.
I support Paul, certainly all the way, but at the same time, I'm a bit worried. But then I think, like, he's 21, like, and he knows his own mind, and I hope he's doing the right thing. I back him all the way.
The women of Derry have a tradition of strength. Their work in the linen mills has provided the economic backbone of many families. Annie Gallagher is an SDLP member who has served on the city council for 4 years.
Attitude towards things, you know, things are going to really get better. You know, not cure the problems but, you know, make it a wee bit better.
Even the children are involved in this new political process.
My father is running for the city side, the SDLP, running for council.
This is Anthony Carlin, Jr.
How do you feel about him running?
I think it's good, sort of. Gives him a good chance. And I hope
he
can get
on. Well, my son Anthony, of course, is not 12 years of age yet. He has become probably more actively involved than any other member of the family. He has been practically living in the SDLP election headquarters throughout this campaign.
I just go around canvassing and putting up posters for them and taking messages down the office. Anytime they need me down, I come down.
What do you think of the people that you met in the SDLP?
I think they're all nice, so they are. Very kind, they take you around places. They're a good laugh.
Humor and camaraderie are the currency of the campaign. The only currency of the campaign. No one gets paid. One of the many volunteers is Verna McIver, campaign director for Derry, a teacher and a mother of five.
Being in politics in Northern Ireland and in non-violent politics is difficult. The vast majority of people support it, but extremists don't make life easy for people who stand up to them. And I believe that people like myself who are public figures is one thing, but are ordinary workers in the ground who live in areas where violent organizations are active. I think those people are people of great and enormous courage, and they are standing up for the real principles of democracy at the end of the day.
And I hope it turns out the results for us and for yourself.
Thank you very much, John.
The SDLP candidates include three unemployed factory workers, a nurse, a teacher, a social worker, a carpenter, and a printer. They run for election in their own neighborhoods. Sinn Fein, representing the IRA interests, opposes them for the 20 seats allotted to nationalist areas.
Thanks, Joe.
In prior years, the IRA asked its supporters to boycott such elections. Now they want them to vote. Polling places are heavily guarded. Jim Guy, a voice of moderation in the Protestant community, brings food to his election workers at one of the voting sites. Once inside, poll watchers cannot leave. In past years, there have been attacks on election workers and voters. Still, the people come out in spite of the threats of violence. As Paul O'Donnell checks the polls, a young campaign worker waits and watches. John Tierney hopes for a large voter turnout in spite of a televised soccer match.
Well, the poll at this moment in time is about 50 to 52%, and we were hoping for 60 to 65%. Hopefully they'll all come out now because there's a European Cup match on, and we're hoping that after that's over, which I'm told is over in another 10 minutes, that they'll come out.
As night comes and the polls close, there is optimism mixed with the usual caution.
Got an excellent turnout from all our supporters, and they've come out very, very strong this time. People who haven't voted, young people have come out to vote because the SDLP have been putting up a young candidate, and we've got great support. Colin here is a young boy from Gobnascale, not even turned voting age yet, interested in the SDLP, the work which they are doing, and when he's 18, we'll be getting him into the SDLP, and he gave me a great hand today, and it shows that young people is interested in making a solution to Northern Ireland and peace and prosperity for all the people in both sections of the community.
Do you think there'll be any problems after it's over?
They will, of course. There'll be usual run the gauntlet, you know, stones, bottles, petrol bombs, and maybe an odd blast of gunfire. You may hear it, you know. So as soon as the poll's over at 10 o'clock, get away as fast as possible, you know. That's the way it goes.
Tank-like army vehicles bring in the ballot boxes. The election night has brought violence. Armored cars firebombed. A 10-year-old wounded by a plastic bullet. But the vote has been taken. Here, people gather at the city hall to wait for the count. A slow process where paper ballots are tallied by hand. The candidates arrive. For one, violence struck close to home.
Our youngest candidate is a young lad called Paul O'Donnell. When polling finished, he returns home. He had fought a very tough, hard election, confronted his opponents and those who support violence. Returns home to find his car outside his home in an ordinary working class area burned out. That's the sort of thing that has happened often, particularly at election time when the feelings run high.
Unintimidated, Paul is at the count supported by his colleagues.
We know about fascism. Most of us have experienced it. But anyway.
We've been there fighting for the good people. The good people of this city need us.
The decent
people of this city need us, and we'll be there fighting for them.
Yeah, we still vote in there.
Are we going in then?
No.
Our share of the vote.
The initial vote from the first electoral district comes in. One Sinn Féin councillor is elected, and a BBC crew records the IRA demonstration. This crew spent 2 months in Derry working on a documentary called The Edge of the Union, but chose to speak only to the representatives of the extremes, Martin McGuinness of Sinn Féin and Gregory Campbell, follower of Ian Paisley. They chose not to interview the city's Member of Parliament, John Hume, Mayor John Tierney, or anyone who speaks for moderation in either community. Thus, there was little media attention when the rest of the first district vote was tallied.
What's happened now is that there's six elected for the city side, and the six are Brady, Sinn Féin, Carlin, SDLP, Devine, SDLP, McGuinness, Sinn Féin, McLaughlin, Sinn Féin, and Ramsey, SDLP. The SDLP and the Sinn Féin.
Though there were six more districts to come in, there was concern. For the election to end in a tie with Sinn Féin was not good enough. SDLP needed a mandate to convince the outside world that they did speak for the Catholic nationalist community. The afternoon would bring John Tierney's count. It would be a referendum not only for the young man's year as mayor, but for the idea that change can come through the democratic process. While 20 years ago, Tierney's parents, as Catholics, would have been afraid to even enter City Hall, today, he is the mayor. Would the people endorse this sign of hope? Tierney tops the poll. The rest of the day belongs to the SDLP. They win 14 seats in the city council, an increase of one from the last election. Sinn Fein takes five. The results are the same across the north. Over 60% of the Catholic population casts a vote for nonviolence.
He's our new candidate, Noel McKenna. Former Mayor Councillor Willie O'Connell has just been re-elected. Teresa Coyle has just been re-elected, and Mary Bradley. Of course, you know our two lady councillors, Councillor Annie Courtney and Councillor Annie Gallagher.
In the next campaign, in 4 years' time in the local government elections, there will be more women running. Yeah.
What do you think? Have we got a penny?
So
we did.
We're
doing it.
The last time. My son, Raymond. One of the younger members of the party. One of the newer types. You can understand from the haircut that the SDLP is changing its image slightly.
I'm delighted for Pat because my fellow set and the old corporation as a Labour councillor and alderman, and I'm proud that Pat is going to sit where he did sit. He never had a chance of being mayor or deputy mayor, but I hope Pat does.
The election's over now, and it went very well. 14 out of 20 got in. That's very good.
We've taken our seats, the 14 seats, as we expected to take, and in the future, we'll build again. Unfortunately, we lost one or two well-known candidates or well-known past councillors, but the young blood has taken over. Girls have taken over, and it'll make a great difference to the council. I thank you very much.
It was a great victory. A victory for democracy and for those who work for peace in Northern Ireland. It was a victory for hope, and by extension, for all of us who look for peaceful and civilized solutions to the problems of this world.
Well, my mother once said, and she had very many graphic phrases, my mother had, that if you're reared in your bare feet, you'll never get pneumonia in the snow. When you grow up in a society where it's normal to be searched when you go into a shop, where it's normal to see troops marching and just walking through the streets, policing the streets with weapons, where it's normal to see military vehicles and police vehicles, which are really militaristic, or police stations surrounded by rampart. People get used to that, but it does create an underlying tension in the atmosphere. This present young generation in the North have lost an awful lot because of violence. I hope that it won't be too long till we lift that burden from them, and so that future generations can live in an Ireland which the rest of the world likes to love, but an Ireland which the Irish themselves can at last have a respect and pride in.
The Irish Children's Fund reaches out to the youth of troubled Northern Ireland. If you would like to host a child from the tension areas of Belfast this summer, please write the Irish Children's Fund, 5602 Hillcrest Road, Downers Grove, Illinois, 60516. Wednesday at 8, Smithsonian World serves you a slice of American pie. You'll get the taste of a small town celebration. The different architectural styles of American churches. Our nation's largest airplane show in Oshkosh. And a portrait of George Washington. Then at 9,
virtually every observatory in the world will be focusing on Halley as it swings by. Radio telescopes as well as optical. Thousands of astronomers, professionals and amateurs alike, have joined an international Halley watch, planning, coordinating and sharing their observations of the comet. It'll be under scrutiny day and night around the world, each burst of activity documented. Never before has a single celestial object been the target of such intense examination.
Examine the most famous comet and others Wednesday, right after American Pie on Smithsonian World.
I'm Marty Stauffer. Garter snakes that mate by the thousands. Lizards that change costume as well as color. Alligators that bellow in primeval swamps. Turtles that battle like armored tanks. They're all remarkable reptiles. But are they slimy, scaly monsters or nature's survival specialists? They've held us spellbound for centuries, and they'll capture your imagination too. Next on Wild America.
Another view of Wild America, Thursday at 8.
I'm Michael Medved, co-host of Sneak Previews, your weekly guide to the new movies in town.
And I'm Jeffrey Lyons. Next time, we'll take a look at the nominees for this year's Academy Awards. We'll show scenes from all the contenders in the major categories.
And of course, you're going to hear our predictions of who we think is going to win.
That's an in-depth look at this year's Academy Awards on the next Sneak Previews.
A Sneak Preview Special Edition, Thursday at 8:30.
Lunch at the club, a game of golf, a cricket match. Meet Charters and Caldecott, two very proper English gentlemen who find their lives disrupted by the discovery of a corpse.
Stabbed. Dead as a doornail.
Charters and Caldecott, next time on Mystery.
The Mystery begins Thursday at 9. Programming on Channel 11 is underwritten in part by Waste Management.
In just 3 years, we've made over 200 million pounds of hazardous waste vanish from the face of the earth, destroying it with high temperature incineration. Without harm to the environment. We call that making progress.
On the 11 watch, a Navy salvage ship returned to Cape Canaveral this evening after spending 3 days salvaging wreckage of the shuttle Challenger from the floor of the Atlantic. The ship may have brought back more remains of the doomed Challenger crew. President Reagan sent a letter to Congress today saying he plans to continue enforcing his economic sanctions against the white minority government of South Africa.
Vito Marzullo is retiring from the city council, but not before we present a rare insight into the workings and dealings of a Chicago ward boss tomorrow at 6:30 on Chicago Tonight.
Hello, my name is Gus. You're now watching Channel 11 WTTW Chicago.
The Chicago presentation of this program is made possible in part by Boulevard Bank. Committed to business, growing with business, earning your business every day. Member Boulevard Bancorp.
This
This is the Nightly Business Report, brought to you by Digital Equipment Corporation and its newest VAX systems. If you want computer systems designed to save the costs of system expansion and help you to be more competitive, Digital has it now. By Dean Witter. Ask one of our account executives why a Dean Witter IRA can be better than money in the bank. Dean Witter, member of the Sears Financial Network. And public television stations across the nation.
Good evening, everyone. With oil prices down 50% since the start of the year, OPEC oil ministers met today in Geneva in their latest effort to reverse the decline. But as European correspondent Shelley Carabel reports from Geneva, the ministers decided to put off any decisions until tomorrow, when a group of oil market experts issues a report.
Today's three-hour session ended at lunchtime with the 13 OPEC ministers seeking refuge in what the cartel's president called bilateral talks. Late in the day, the chief of Iraq's delegation said the ministers had reached a political consensus to return to production limits to stabilize oil prices. Observers here in Geneva say this agreement in principle means OPEC's two main factions are beginning to see eye to eye. On the one hand, the Saudis, Kuwaitis, and other wealthy Gulf states who in December supported the move to end production quotas that resulted in this unprecedented price drop. And on the other hand, Iran, Algeria, and Libya, some of OPEC's poorer members, who now admit the only way to stabilize prices is to cut production. But can a consensus within OPEC alone work? Petroleum analysts say not without the support of non-OPEC producers such as Great Britain and Norway. In the past, such disarray has sent OPEC ministers home. Today, to observers here, they appear prepared to stick it out. In Geneva, I'm Shelley Carabel for the Nightly Business Report.
Well, this evening in Geneva, Carabel asked Saudi Arabian oil minister Sheikh Ahmed Zaki Yamani whether the OPEC ministers are near an agreement. Yamani pointed his eyes skyward and with skepticism in his voice said, agreement? What do you mean agreement? Adding, we're working on it. Linda?
Well, meanwhile, Exxon Chairman Clifton Garvin warns that if OPEC fails to agree on ways to stem the oil price decline, oil prices could fall further. Speaking to reporters in Detroit, Garvin said there is no technical bottom to the current oil price drop. The Exxon chairman added that a continued fall of oil prices will eventually put OPEC back in the driver's seat as exploration for new oil reserves grinds to a halt for a lack of money.
A big decline in the number of new oil and gas wells in this country led the operating rate of U.S. industry to drop last month. As a result, the nation's factories, mines, and utilities used only 80% of their capacity in February, 0.6% less than January's operating rate. It was the second monthly drop in a row and the biggest decline in the capacity utilization rate since last October. That came as a surprise to many economists who generally believe the economy is in the midst of a modest expansion. Paul?
If you wanted to make any of the long green in the stock market on this St. Patrick's Day, you'd have had to been as short as a leprechaun because prices took a tumble. But after last week's huge gains, a closing loss of a bit less than 16 points on the Dow Industrial Average didn't seem enough to dampen any St. Patty's Day party spirit. Like a tire that was heavily overinflated, the stock market expanded 39 points on the Dow last Friday, thanks largely to some overblown index futures buying. But plenty of overdue profit-taking put a good-sized puncture into prices at the outset today, and by 10:30 a.m., the industrial average dropped nearly 21.5 points, which momentarily flattened Wall Street's bullish bounce. By 11 a.m., the industrial average did cut its deficit to 17.75 points, but losing stocks maintained an overwhelming 1,200-300 lead over gainers, which kept traders on the defensive. As a result, prices began to fade again during mid-session, especially after oil-rich Kuwait reportedly offered to cut its production and one of the first signs by an OPEC country to cooperate in an attempt to reverse the sharp recent drop in oil prices. The industrial average reacted by dropping back down to a 20.5-point loss at 1 p.m., when 12 stocks were still lower for every three higher. Prices stabilized at their broadly lower levels in mid-afternoon when traders were somewhat encouraged by the drop in volume from the recent pace when the market was moving sharply higher. Nevertheless, there were no signs of a comeback as traders apparently decided to tone down their buying enthusiasm while awaiting further developments. At 3 p.m. then, the Dow was still down almost 21.25 points with losers leading gainers 1,250 to 450. The last hour finally brought an improvement in the market, thanks in part to signs of strength in such stalwarts as IBM and General Motors. So the Dow Industrial Average managed to cut its closing loss to 15.92 at 1776.82. The high of the day, 1790.59. The low way down at 1758 and a fraction. Trading volume way down to 137.5 million shares. The Dow Transport Index off 12.14. The airlines were a bit weak on this talk of higher oil prices. Utilities down 2.82 and the Dow 65 off just over 8 points. The Standard & Poor's 500 off 1.88, similar losses in the 400 and 100. The SPOC 250, a loser of just over 0.75 points. New York Stock Exchange Index down 1.10, Value Line losing just over 2 points, and the Wilshire 5000 down nearly 21 points. I'll be back shortly to show you where the action was in today's market.
On the precious metals markets today, gold climbed $6 in London to $352.75. In later New York trading, gold gained $1.90 to close at $349.80, while silver rose a dime to finish at $5.77 the ounce. On the New York money markets, the dollar was mostly lower today, hitting a post-war record low against the yen. It also finished down against the Swiss franc and Canadian dollar, but closed marginally higher against the British pound.
Trans World Airlines says it is flying 85% of its domestic flights and all of its international routes, despite the 11-day-old strike by its union flight attendants. In Washington, about 100 of the striking flight attendants today demonstrated in front of Federal Aviation Administration headquarters, claiming that replacement flight attendants now on TWA flights lack proper training and onboard emergency procedures, making the airline unsafe. But a TWA spokesman denied that claim, saying everything is going according to the strike plan. No new talks between the two sides are scheduled.
Dean, although it hasn't received as much attention as the TWA strike, a walkout by more than 7,000 workers at General Electric plants in Lynn, Massachusetts, is nearing the one-month mark. The striking GE workers are involved in the manufacture of engines for military aircraft. But as Marianne Kane reports, what's different about this strike is that money isn't the issue.
For the past month, members of the International Union of Electrical Workers, Local 201, have been yelling scab and picketing the entrances to the General Electric Aircraft Engine Division in Lynn, Massachusetts. 7,400 have walked off the job, essentially stopping production on $1 billion worth of government contracts on engines for the F-18 jet and Black Hawk helicopter. The issue isn't money. According to the union, there's a breakdown in the contracted grievance procedure.
It deals with the step one relationship between stewards and foremen, a recognition that when stewards are acting as agents of the union at the step one level, the grievance capacity, that they deserve a little respect there.
That respect, says GE spokesman Bill Kennedy, is really a demand for equal power, something GE calls a revolutionary request.
And that we cannot agree that the steward in the shop is going to be share the status of the boss, who in this case is the foreman.
According to economist David Weiss, non-economic conflicts like this one are very difficult to settle, and he sees it as an indication of new union militancy in this nation.
Now that times are getting better, the unemployment rate is down to a reasonable level, and in Massachusetts to a very low level, the unions feel they can afford to put a little more pressure on management.
In terms of economic pressure, striking employees are losing $3.5 million in salary per week. As for GE, no significant revenue has been lost so far, but that could change within weeks.
In April or early May, we might have some delay of some engines.
There are estimates that the strike could eventually cost GE $4 million plus per week, and there could be layoffs. As for the union, leaders say its survival is at stake.
Does go to the basics on whether or not this union is able to legitimately operate and get answers to the problems we present.
For the rank and file, it's a matter of dignity.
I just want them to treat us like human beings instead of like dogs.
I hope that the people in there realize that we are all people. We're all in this together.
Negotiations between union and management have been going on for the past couple of weeks. In fact, they were even underway today. But so far, no progress is reported. In Lynn, Massachusetts, I'm Marianne Kane for the Nightly Business Report.
The executive board of the United Steelworkers Union has approved a tentative contract with LTV, the nation's second largest steelmaker. The 40-month contract would cost LTV workers $3.15 per hour in wages and benefits, but in exchange, they would receive a share of the company's profits and stock. LTV lost $227 million last year. The company says it must reduce its cash flow to avoid bankruptcy. The agreement must still be approved by LTV employees. LTV stock today closed at 9 3/8, down a quarter. Paul?
Well, Wall Street's bulls had to steel themselves against some profit-taking today, but let's look at these closing averages, and I think you'll agree it hardly really disturbed last week's overall 93-point advance on the Dow all that much, down a little less than 16 points. Transports off 12.14, utilities off nearly 3 points, and then a little better than point-size losses in the broadly-based indexes you see at the bottom of your screen. Trading volume today way down from Friday's pace and the pace we've seen all through the recent uptrend, so that's a good sign from the technical standpoint. And down volume did exceed up volume, however, by better than 2-1. The advanced decline ratio is still heavily weighted in favor of losers, about 12-5, but nothing like it was in early trading today. 139 new highs for the year, nevertheless, and only 11 new lows. Topping the active list on 2.6 million shares, Detroit Edison down a quarter, could have something to do all this activity with the fact the stock goes ex-dividend 42 cents this coming Thursday. IBM, that was a psychological booster, up 0.5 point on the close. American Telephone dropped 3/8. Eastman Kodak up 1.5. Rumors around that Ivan Boesky now has been buying the stock. Other rumors say the company's going to have a big buyback program, nothing confirmed. Western Airlines back in the takeover rumor spotlight, up 5/8 of a point. Phillips Petroleum edged up an eighth, and a fairly